Actually, when anytime I have to suffer from an outage, I'm feeling like a policer trying to find where the problem is coming from. And it's not that easy. You have to SSH on every single machine. You have to open the right directory to find where the logs are, look at every logs and try to combine all that. So this is not an easy task. You probably know this script. Basically, everything is fine. There is just a little fire somewhere. It's not that close, so that's OK. But at some point, you will see that the entire house is burning. You should better stop the fire before it gets to every single room, so because now you have a big problem to solve. And what you can do to solve all those problems, actually, you need to collect information. And what you want to collect, everything. This is the thing that you should do, is to collect everything. It can be logs, it can be pings on the service that you are running, it can be a performance information, what have you. So I'm developer and evangelist. I'm more evangelist now at Elastic. And what does it mean? It means that I'm building Hello World applications. This is only what I'm doing now. But what we are trying to do when we are running demos like this, we are trying to make it appear like if it was in the real world, like in production. So when we designed this application, for example, we were using HTTPS to make sure it behaves like it would behave on production. I'm going to use this repository for the demo, so everything has been deployed. I will show you the architecture later to showcase all the things. Here we are using Spring Boot as the base of the application, and we have different services running. The application is super simple. It does not make any fancy things. There is a database somewhere involved, but yeah, this is really a simple application. And it's super simple as well because we are not using any discovery or load balancing, but you can totally adapt to this talk to and extend it to load balancing or what have you. It will be exactly the same thing. This application has been deployed on AWS in cloud, so everything is running there. And we are using the cheapest AWS version, which is a LightSail. We are using Terraform to automate the creation of the instances, and Ansible to deploy our services. And this is running under Ubuntu 16-something. In this application, I'm going to collect a lot of things, and all the data that I'm going to collect are going to be sent in Elastic Cloud. So Elastic Cloud is the official Elasticsearch as a service available on cloud. It contains everything you need, including some exclusive features, such as SQL, for example, monitoring, machine learning for anomaly detection, and all that things. All what I'm going to show you today is available for free, and because we open also all our source code, including commercial features, you can also read the code of what is running actually in production when you are using Elastic Stack in general, including the commercial plugins. So I mentioned Elastic Stack. Who does not know Elastic at all and Elastic Stack? Do we have people who don't know Elastic? Some of you, okay. So at Elastic, we are building this thing that we call Elastic Stack. So this is made of Elasticsearch. Elasticsearch is basically a search engine, distributed search engine, where you have a REST interface and you can send JSON document to the REST interface. Elasticsearch will store, index the document that you send, and you will be able to search for the documents, whatever the size of the documents you have. And analyze the content, like doing some computation, like computing some metrics or that kind of things on top of Elasticsearch. It can scale out, so you can have petabytes of data indexed inside an Elasticsearch cluster if you wish. On top of that, we have Kibana. So Kibana is the front end that we are using to visualize the data that we have in Elasticsearch. It provides also over application on top of Elasticsearch. I mentioned machine learning before, so you have a dedicated application for that, which is running inside Kibana as well. On the ingest layer part, we have two kind of different components. So we have the bits component. We are going to focus today on those one, and I'm going to explain what they do. But in general, bits are agents that you put on your machine, and they are responsible to collect the data and then ship the data that has been collected to Elasticsearch, where it's indexed. Logstash, we are not going to see Logstash today. Logstash is an ETL, so you extract from a source, you transform the data on the fly, and then you load to the data to a destination. It can be Elasticsearch, it can be another destination, such as S3, if you want to archive your data, for example, or many other things. So ETL. So you can basically read from bits, send to Logstash, do some processing here, some advanced processing, and send that to Elasticsearch. So this is what you can do with the stack. All that is available for free. And you can manage the deployment of those components by yourself. So you just download from the website all the things and you deploy that by yourself. Or you can use what we call Elastic Cloud Enterprise, which is a commercial product, where you can deploy easily your Elasticsearch cluster and you can deploy your Kibana with all the security, all the things that you need. We are running the same product ourselves on internet on two different platforms, which are Google Cloud Platform and AWS. And this is our software as a service offer, our Elasticsearch as a service offer that you can find. The name is Elastic Cloud if you want to test it. What we have today, the application we have, is built on AWS, and we have two different services, so two microservices. One is the front end, and one is the back end. I'm missing a piece here, there is also MySQL running here in the back end, but basically this is what we have. On every single machine that we deployed, we also added some bits component. So one of the bits component we added is AuditBit. AuditBit is responsible to do some security audit, like if anyone removes, for example, a file from a file system that you are monitoring, then you will be aware that this event happened. Or if someone tried to, I don't know, to break your security or something, yeah, you can be aware of that. FileBit is for logs. You will see that in a second in the demo. So with that, you can stream your logs to Elasticsearch and then index the logs that you are collecting. MetricBit is about all the metrics that you can collect on the platform. We will see that as well. And PacketBit is about the network card. We have another component here, another service, another machine. The name is Monitor. And basically, this machine adds this bit, EarthBit. EarthBit is responsible to do pings every 10 seconds, for example, or so, to check that the backend and the frontend are still alive, and what is the response time, and things like that. And because we love monitoring what we do, we also monitor the monitor component with other bits components. It makes sense. So monitor everything if you can. And everything that we are collecting here on those machines are then shipped to Elastic Cloud, where we have our Elasticsearch and Kibana running. Okay. So on Elastic Cloud, you can. So this is basically the what we have. You can choose different kind of profiles depending on what your use case is. Here I'm collecting time series data, so like logs and things like that, so I need more disk space than memory. So there is a ratio for this profile, but if you are doing, for example, just search as a service, probably you need less disk space but more memory, for example. So you can choose the profile you want. Here I have three Elasticsearch instances. One is only a tiebreaker, but here I have the data located here and here, so I have 60 gigabytes of disk. We also activated machine learning. I'm not going to showcase machine learning today. This is a commercial product. I don't want to mention that today. And we have also a Kibana instance running here. And you can, when you go to cloud, you can choose whatever parameter you want. If you want to have more memory, for example, for Kibana, you can just slide the cursor and then do what you need. Showtime. So let's do that. I will need your help at some point. I will give you a QR code and a URL after. So if you have a laptop ready or a phone, prepare your phone. We need your help to send some requests to the service to see what is happening. So, what do I have? Yeah, I need my notes here. So, let's open Kibana. So I have here my Kibana instance running in the cloud. I already connected and authenticate myself. What we can do is to look at the monitoring application here. So this, if the Wi-Fi works, hopefully. Otherwise, that will be a pain. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. Plan B, 3G connection, or what? Okay. That's a pain. Let's try this one. Okay. This one. Okay. So let's go to the monitoring tab. So the monitoring tab helps you to see what is monitored by the stack. Monitor in terms of internal Elastic Stack components. I'm not speaking about the application. I'm not speaking about the the Nginx frontend that I have, but just internal components. So here I have my Elasticsearch instance. So I have four nodes here. Yeah, one is for machine learning probably. Number of indices that I have my Kibana running, but what is interesting here is to see the bits that I mentioned before. So I have three audit bit components running, so one for each instance, so the backend, the frontend, and the monitor. Same for file bit, same for metric bit, same for packet bit, and I have one earth bit running on the monitor instance that I mentioned, and so earth bit is also running here on that machine. We can go inside the bits component and have a look at, for example, file bit on the backend. Let's see this one. So if you go to the monitoring page, you will see, for example, the number of events per second that are sent by the file bit on this backend.zira that, what the fuck, URL. And so this is interesting actually to see, and my advice would be to monitor the fact that your bits are always sending data here, so you can do that, maybe add some alerts on those events if you wish. So anyway, so this is a view of the bits component that we have. If we go to the discover point here, we are going to see that I'm connected by default to an index named metric bit. So here I have the metric bit index, or indices in general, because I'm collecting data from different days. You can see here some events that have been collected by metric bit. So if I look inside one of the events, I should maybe zoom a bit like this. You will see, for example, what is the bit name. So this metric bit document is coming from the backend. What do I have? Things like the CPU and the metric set. Okay, so the metric set name here is CPU. It means that the metric that we are collecting with this line, with this document, is a CPU metric. And then we have some data here. What is the usage probably? Yeah, the user percentage. Okay, so my machine is not running that hard for now. So this is one of the JSON document. If we look at the metric set module, so here I have one of the fields that I'm collecting is the metric set module. If I look at this one, what can I see here is that if, for example, it's 3 a.m. in the morning and I'm responsible for this platform, but I'm not sure of what is running on the platform, just by looking at what I have here, I can see that on my platform, probably, I have a HTTP server, an Nginx server, and a MySQL server somewhere. Okay, so I can discover things, even I don't have the architecture plan here. We can have a look at, HTTP, for example. If I click here, I can add a filter. So now I'm going to see only HTTP information, related information, and what do I have? Something like, yes, the host, where this thing is running, Tomcat, there is what, a count, some metrics here. Okay, so we have some data collected by metric bit, and we can see that this one, for example, is coming from the HTTP interface. What metric bit is doing, metric is responsible to collect metrics every X seconds, so let's say 10 seconds. It's like running a top on your machine and collecting all the results of the top and send that to Elasticsearch. And also for some application server that or service that we are aware of, like Nginx, HTTP, or MySQL, for example, we can collect some specific metrics related to those services. If I'm going, we can also, because everything is indexed in Elasticsearch, we can also create some visualization out of that. And we can say, okay, let's create a visualization. I'm going to create a vertical bar visualization on metric bit index. If it works. Yes. And for the X axis, for example, I can say, okay, let's see what is the module. Module here, metric set module, let's run that. Okay, so I have system module, so those are like running the top that I mentioned before, the HTTP module, Joe, Lokia, Nginx, and MySQL. And I can also break this with another terms and say, okay, let's break by bit name, just to see what we have. Okay, so I have the front end is the green, the monitor, and the back end instances. Okay, I can see, for example, if I choose this one on MySQL, if I just want to see MySQL, I can see that MySQL is only running in the back end instance. Okay, so I know basically what I have here. So you can create your visualization like this, right, and do that by yourself, but fortunately, with the Elastic Stack, you by default, all the Bits components are providing their own set of visualization and their own set of dashboards. So you don't have to do that manually. If you go to dashboards, you will see that there is a lot of dashboards already available. And if I go to metric bit something, I should have a system host overview, metric bit system overview. Yeah, this one, probably. Let's go. Okay. So in this one, I have a set of visualization all put together within a dashboard, so I can understand, okay, what is the current usage by CPU broken by the service that I have, so the monitor, the backend, and the frontend. And same for memory. I can see that backend is probably using more memory than the frontend and the other ones. You can go in details. So I should not choose this one. This one is not probably interesting. Let's go to the backend one. So you can click on one and now deep dive inside the backend and have more in-depth details information about what is happening on your backend machine. Okay, so you can monitor that easily. We can see, for example, where are here. So we can see the processes here that are running, and we can see what is the usage on the backend service by process. So we can see that we have a Java process which is running and taking a lot of memory, Java, you know. And then we have MySQL, and then we have the packet bit, metric bit, audit bit, so those are taking a small amount of data. And same by CPU, so we can see that Java is using a lot, 1.6%, that's not a lot for now, of the CPU on the machine. And you can do that for the front-end, why not? Let's do that for the front-end, we'll see that. So going back, front-end. So what do we have here in terms of data. So we just have a Java process which is running, which is, Nginx maybe, I don't know. What can we do here? What can we see? Okay, we can see some kind of spike here in the memory usage. Oops, that's probably, I zoomed too much probably. Okay, so there are here some spikes, so maybe we can try to explain that or not, but okay. What I want to show you now. Okay, so when you have a dashboard like this, you can use it as a base for monitoring your activity, but if you are missing some pieces that you want to understand, you can always build a visualization that I mentioned before and put that in the dashboard, so enhance the default dashboard that we are providing. So to do that, you can do like a new visualization. I'm going to do that. I want to show you what we call the visual builder. So this is dedicated to time series data. So here, what I'm just showing is the number of documents that I'm collecting per second or per time frame. I don't know what it is. But what I want to do, for example, I want to understand how my memory is used. So instead of doing a count here, I can do a sum here, for example, on a specific field, and I know that in my data I have something named system.memory.usagebytes. I think this is the one. No, used bytes. Why is that? Used bytes. This one. Okay, so this is the sum of the memory usage. So as you can see, there is a row number here, which is not super easy to understand. So you can always change the options. And instead of displaying a number, you can say, OK, those are bytes now. So what I can see is the total usage of the memory on the three microservices that I have. But what I can do, I can also break this data by the bit name, which is the service name here. So here I can say bit.name. So now I can see the usage per kind of instances. So I have the usage for the backend, the usage for the monitor instance, and the usage for the front end, where we can see this spike that we have seen before. Okay. So you have an overview here of MetricBit. So to install MetricBit, just super easy, just download it. Install it on your machine and start it as a service, and then you're done, basically. You have to configure where to ship the data to, but that's the only thing you have to do, basically. And now I will need your help. So you have to connect to this page. Where is that? This page, xira.whatthefuck. So if you have a, you can take the QR code. And if you go to this page, you will see you have different URL where you can play with, and you can send requests to the service. So this page is the front end, and basically this page is going to call the back end, okay, and do some things. And we'll see what is going to happen. So xiraa.wtf. Okay. Enough. So the URL is there. If you did not have time, okay, to note it. So you can do many things with that. If you are curious, and if you have a laptop, you can also try to SSH on the machine. Try to do some connections, and we'll see if we can see something or not. We'll see. So you can run some queries like this one. It's just 200. Okay, hello world. I can do more. Not sure if you are doing that yourself. So this is just a simple call. I'm not sure there is a call to the backend here. Not, I don't remember. You can call with a parameter and say, okay, I can even add emoji, I think, inside. Yeah. Oops. Yeah. Let's add an emoji. Yeah. We also support emojis in our logs and whatever. So this. You can generate a 500 error. Why not? So this is a bad page. Right. Okay. So we are collecting a lot of things. Let's do another one, maybe the 404. Yeah, so this one is a 404. And while this is running, we have packet bits running on the machines. So we have packet bits running on the front end, this instance, but we have also packet bits running on the back end. So anytime you are doing a request, packet bit is trying to understand and to take from the network card all the requests that you did, understand the content, and ship that to Elasticsearch. So this is like running Wireshark on the network card in real time and sending that and streaming the content to Elasticsearch. So this is basically what PacketBit is doing. So if we go now to the dashboard, so again, you don't have to build the dashboard by yourself, you just have to open the default one that we are providing. So you can go to packet bit overview. Yeah, let's see if you are doing things or not. Apparently you are. So here, this is, we can see that we have some web transactions here. And if I look at here, yeah, and we have also some MySQL transaction running. I did not do anything. I mean, I did not change my application. I'm just listening to what is happening on the network card. Okay, that's all what I'm doing here. So we can see some spikes here. Okay, some errors. That's interesting. Okay, of course. I did generate some errors myself. So you have many information here. So we saw that we have some web transactions, so we can go to a dedicated dashboard about web transactions. If we look at what we have, so this is the activity that we are seeing now. This is broken also by error codes. So, and what are the queries that we are seeing? And the number of queries. So for example, let's see at the 500. Oh, there is only one. One for, okay. Let's look, no. 820. So if we look at the 500 error code, we can see that this is coming from those URL, for example. And this is the when those errors happened. If we look at another one, the 404, okay. So this is when the 404 happened as well. If we look at the MySQL, if you called some endpoint which are calling the back end and then the database, we can see that here. We can see that we have some calls. And we can see some information like what are the most frequent MySQL queries that are run on our database, so commits. So this is a counter for Hibernate here, then a commit, then select user, and then some select some data probably, updates. And then what are the slowest MySQL queries that we have seen. Okay. Again, you did not change anything to your application, you are just monitoring what is happening on your different microservices that are running in production. So this is about the network card, but we can also have a look at what FileBit is doing. So FileBit is collecting logs, and if we look at the logs we have on the platform, I'm not connecting anymore, so this is not this one, okay. I need a password, so probably we will need to change the password after the session, because everything is recorded and now it's done. So let's have a look at what we have. So if we look at not this one, sorry. We have Nginx running, and what we have here, again, my password. Who called this URL with this value? Okay, who is refreshing now the browser? Okay, thank you for your help. So you can see that we are generating a lot of data. Okay, yeah, we can change. Yeah, thank you. and So all the data that we are collecting is not super well structured, actually. And to be indexed inside Elasticsearch, we need to parse those logs and then say that the first part is the IP address, then we have a user, probably, then we have a date, we have the verb, the URL, the version of the server, what is the browser you are using, and even this browser information is not super well formed. So what the FileBit component is doing, when you activate a module named NGINX, it knows exactly where we can find the log file on your machine. So you don't have to define that. And we know also how to parse NGINX logs like this. So we are creating automatically in Elasticsearch in a feature named ingest pipeline, the right pipeline to be able to parse your data. And with that, we are able to then visualize. I think I have a dashboard for FileBit, maybe. Maybe not, I don't remember. FileBit, do I have? Yeah. So the FileBit NGINX overview, if I look at this one, because we done all this parsing and all this enrichment of your data by default, we are able to display, for example, on a map where our users are coming from, right? So maybe I will be able to locate who wrote penis in the presentation, in the room, I don't know, we'll see. If I zoom in, no, I can't, I'm kidding. But, so how does it work actually? Because we have an IP address in the ingest pipeline that Elasticsearch is creating, FileBit is creating by default, this IP address is parsed and converted to geolocation point. And because we have the longitude and latitude corresponding to this IP address, then we can display it here on a map. So we have some people here in Luxembourg trying to connect. So maybe you have a VPN to Luxembourg and then you are coming back. Maybe this is what you are doing. We do. Maybe. Roaming? Yeah, roaming, probably. That can work. And here, maybe we can zoom in a bit. Yeah, my 4G connection is dying, maybe. But anyway, you understand the principle where you can display on the map where the attack is coming from. Sometimes we have an attack from China. It's happening a lot of time because we have open instances like this one. And we can see the distribution of the log. So everything, so the raw log file, raw log line, sorry, that I mentioned before, so those logs, right, are totally transformed to be able to generate those dashboards out of the box. So you don't have to do anything. Just activate the NGINX module, and that's all. We are using FileBit, and our application is also generating logs. So we can also parse the logs from our application. So to see that, we have here some so the logs from our application. Script alert lol. Does it work to add the alert lol in the browser? No? Not sure. So if I'm generating some things again, don't know. Let's try this one. Some of them here. We can see that I'm calling this. I can see the logs here. And what I want to do is to parse also those logs, maybe. Lol. If I'm doing that with the 500, this one, what can I see here? So I have a very nice stack trace. Yeah, okay, something went wrong, etc., etc. This is super hard to parse, actually. So we can do that in FileBit, you can parse it. But if you can ask your application to generate JSON logs instead of generating text logs, that would be easier. So here, this is what we did. We configured logback to generate as well JSON logs. So because we have that now, we can just have a very nice stack trace like this one, where everything is within a JSON field, and it's much easier to index that. So it's it helped to remove the parsing of the logs. If I'm showing you how everything has been configured, where is that? Oops. I saw it here. Boof. That's not the right one. What did I do? Not sorry. I'm trying to find my. Yeah, this one. So, what did we do? We said that for our application, we are going to monitor whatever JSON document is modified in this directory. And then we are telling Vybit that this is a JSON document, that you just have to send it as a JSON document. And we are adding another field within the document named application with the value Java, so it will help us to find the documents and to filter the logs by application here by Java. And we activated some modules, and this is one of the I mentioned, because you activate the Nginx modules, then everything is set up for you automatically, right? The parsing of the logs and all what you have. One of the cool things that you can do as well is those two things, and specifically the add cloud underscore metadata. Automatically, Vybit will try to get information about the cloud instance where your microservice is deployed. Because you are going to deploy your microservice to whatever machine, then if you want to have more information about your logs, then you can have that automatically. And if we go again to discover, if my internet works, discover, yes. And if we go to Vybit, now I'm switching from an index to another. Okay. If I go to application here, and I just want to filter the one which are coming from the Java application. So I'm just going to, so those one. So I'm not looking at the Nginx anymore logs. I'm just going to see the one from my application. If I look at what I have here, so those are the lines that we have seen before, right? Some information coming from the JSON content. And what you can see here is the meta cloud information, right? You know on which instance this thing is running, what is the type of the instance where this thing is running, and the region as well. So all that has been provisioned automatically for you. I think we can see, yeah, JSON severity error. We generated some errors here. So those are errors. Let's open one. So here we have one of the stack traces that I mentioned before. One of the cool things of Vybit also, when you have logback, is to be able to generate things like a hash for the stack trace, which means that if you look at this hash, for example, so JSON stack hash, you can see how much similar errors you are getting on your service. If we do a visualization again, a new one, new, and a vertical bar, why not, on 5-bit this time, and we want to split by terms, and this will be the json.hash something, hash. No, what was the name? Stack hash, exactly. So we can see the distribution of our stack trace. And probably if I want to focus on one of the errors that my application is generating now, probably I want to focus on this one because I have a lot of errors coming from this one. And if I solve this problem, I will get rid of a lot of errors at once. So this is a nice thing to have. Okay, so that was Vybit. And then we can have a look at Earthbit. If you remember correctly, I said that on the monitor instance, we have Earthbit running. And what Earthbit is providing us is that kind of dashboard where we can see all the services that are running on our machine here. So This is the current status of our platform, and we have all the different services that we are monitoring with Heartbeat here. If I show you the console, we have the right password. Yes. Where is that? Yeah, it's here. If I show you the configuration of Heartbeat, so this is super easy, simple to understand. Basically, here I'm doing a HTTP call on this service. So this is the ELF endpoint, and this is like a cron tab every 10 seconds or so. Just look at what you have, and this is the response code that you are expecting. Right. I'm also monitoring Kibana here. And what we also do, for example, if you have something which is MySQL, where you cannot ask for HTTP request because MySQL does not expose HTTP endpoint, then you can just do TCP ping. Like. And then just on this port, which is the MySQL one, every 10 seconds try to see what if the service is still running or not. So if we go to the front end again and do something like service stop. So we are going to stop the service. Sometimes at with this talk, I have some people who are running deny of service on the backend, and they are crashing the service themselves. So, but I did it here. And oh, I forgot to activate the auto refresh. So if you do that, then you will probably see that one of your services now is down. Right. I have something down. So my Heartbeat component every 10 seconds is trying to check the health of this service, and there is one of those services which is down. If I click on this one, the down. Yeah, did I? Yeah. So this is it, and if I zoom at this period of time, okay, so I can see that, yeah, this is the front end which is down now. Okay, so I need to fix something. And obviously, I just have to restart it. Oops. Okay, we will see in a second if this one is coming back or not. Okay. It should be back, hopefully, at some point. Yeah, it's coming back. Cool. Yeah, I'm running out of time, so I want to show you something else. So I'm not going to show you that. So what you can do also with Metricbit, so that was Heartbeat, but with Metricbit you can also ask Metricbit to collect information coming from the GMX service that your application can expose. We are using a Jolokia behind the scene, and when we have a GMX kind of endpoint, then we are collecting the data that you need. Okay, last, we have now a new service named APM. So APM helps you to do application performance monitoring. Just to show you how you configure that on your application. So this is here the Java code of my application, but I don't care about it. Just I want to show you that when you start your application, you can just say, okay, use the Java agent that we are using for the APM service. So this is the latest version of the service. Give the service name, so your microservice name. This is the front end, then we will have the back end and what have you. And this is the URL of the APM server. So we have an APM server in the middle. And what this agent is going to do is going to take all the information coming from those packages here and collect that information, ship that to this APM server, and the APM server every, I don't know, maybe 5 seconds or so, will ship that information to Elasticsearch, which means that we can now understand how our application is running in production just by using this agent. So if we go to the APM application here, Again, this is available for free. You just have to download and install and run that. You have here this button. Just want to mention this one. This is important. So you have the setup instructions here. And in the setup instruction, there is things to help you to create the to launch the server, but also here of the on the agent part, you go to Java. Here you download the agent, and then this is exactly what I mentioned before. You just say, okay, this is how you configure the Java client, basically. And then when you're done, you go to APM. Oh, I'm running out of time. So, few words. If you look at the two services that I'm monitoring with APM, I have the front-end part here. And if I look at the last 15 minutes, so this is again a dashboard, this is again data coming from Elasticsearch, but those are specific views of the service. So if we go to, I don't know, search, for example, probably some people did run some search. For now, if I look at this one took a lot of time, one request. What this one did, it was just calling the backend, right? And we can see where that was actually happening in the code, in our Java code. So for now, this is the only view that we have. If we go to the backend, we can see other views. For example, we got the search call, and maybe, I don't know, this one. And if we look at the backend, we can see that this we have like a waterfall view with all the select in the database that happen. For example, here I have this request, and this is the reason our application took a lot of time to answer, because probably this select took a lot of time to run on the MySQL database. Okay. And you have all that information. I'm not going to cover more in details. What we are missing today, but this is coming in the next release, is the distributed tracing. Like from the front end, you can see the back end and then go inside the back end and see the waterfall in the and the SQL execution. So this is coming next in few weeks or months. I don't know exactly what is the time frame for that. Okay, so that was it. Don't have to mention time series and all that stuff. So with the stack, you can build like with Legos, you can deploy your microservices if you wish and add the right monitor tool that you want to add to monitor your microservice. My advice would be to collect all what you can in Elasticsearch, and then because when you have the fire, as I mentioned before, you want to be able to. And you want to make sure that you have all the information needed to understand what happened when this happened. If you want to play with that, the dashboard specifically, so the dashboard will be open for the rest of the day, maybe some 2 days or so. So if you go to dashboard.zira.whatthefuck, you can go and play with the file bit, earth bit, packet bit, APM probably, if you want to play with those URL. And thing. That's okay for the picture. Okay. I don't have time for questions, but I have stickers here. If you want to grab some stickers, feel free to take that. And thank you for your time. J'étais en retard.
Ouais, mais bon, je veux pas voler le temps.